Hello everyone, welcome to Fun with Zoology. Now today we are beginning with the classification of invertebrates. First we shall start with phylum Protozoa. So before going into the classification, we must know about the general characteristics of Protozoa. So let's begin. First we must know that why were the Protozoans named so. So the word Protozoa was derived from two Greek words, protos which means first and zoon which means animal. Next, when did these Protozoans come into existence on the surface of earth? So during the Precambrian era, these Protozoans came into existence on the surface of earth. And now you may not know what is Precambrian era. So after the formation of earth, when the earth was initially not an habitable place, but later it cooled down and different organisms started coming into existence, and from that date till present day, the total time scale is divided into different parts, different periods and eras and so on. And during this Precambrian era, the Protozoans were discovered, or they came into existence on the surface of the earth. The next thing is about some important taxonomic facts about the Protozoans. The first fact is that Leeuwenhoek in 1676 gave the first preliminary account or preliminary details about the Protozoans after the discovery of the microscope. Later, Goldfuss in 1818 coined the term Protozoa, that means he first used the term Protozoa. Also, von Siebold in 1845 recognized the unicellular nature of Protozoans. So here you must know that Protozoans are made up of only one cell. So that feature of the Protozoans was given by von Siebold. Later on, different scientists classified Protozoans, and these different classifications are given by Hyman, Dauphine, then Brusca and so on. So this was all about the different taxonomic facts about the Protozoans. Now we must know about the definition of the Protozoans. So before going into definition, we must know about some particular characters that are found only in the Protozoans. So these Protozoans are, first of all, they are unicellular. Uni means one, and cellular means it is derived from the word cell. So these Protozoans are made up of only one cell. Next is, they are eukaryotes. That means they are not a primitive type. They have a well-defined nucleus, so they are called as eukaryotes. These Protozoans are motile. That means they can move from one place to another. Hence, and another point is that the Protozoans are heterotrophic organisms. That means they have different types of eating behavior. So if we combine all these characters, then we can frame the definition as the Protozoans are unicellular, eukaryotic, commonly motile, heterotrophic organisms. So this is a very easy trick that if you don't forget about the definition, then just recall all the characters of that organism and frame the definition using all the characters. So next we shall start with the general characteristics of the phylum Protozoa. The first characteristic is that they are all microscopic and they are all unicellular organisms. So again, I'm explaining, unicellular means uni means one, and cellular means cell. So all the Protozoans are made up of only one cell. Now since they are made up of only one cell, and cell is the building block of every organism, it is the smallest part of our body, so we cannot see the cell with naked eye. Hence we need microscope to see the Protozoans. So all the Protozoans are microscopic and unicellular organisms. The second point is that the Protozoans show or exhibit different types of body symmetry. Now let me recall about what is body symmetry. Now every animal can be cut into two equal halves if we cut through any particular body axis. Now if an animal cannot be divided into two equal halves if we cut through any body axis, then that animal is said to be asymmetrical. So this is the figure of amoeba, where you can see that if we cut it through any plane, we cannot get two equal halves. That means amoeba is asymmetrical. The next figure is of euglena. So if we cut euglena through the mid plane, then we can get two equal right and left halves. That means euglena shows bilateral symmetry. So from these two examples, you can very well understand that amoeba is asymmetrical, whereas euglena is bilaterally symmetrical. That means different Protozoans show different types of body symmetry. The third point is that all the Protozoans are single, means maximum of the Protozoans are single. They live in a single manner, they live solo, but some Protozoans are colonial, that means they live in groups. The fourth point is that the body of Protozoans are bounded by a cell membrane. Now we know that all the animal cells are bounded by a cell membrane. These Protozoans are made up of only one cell, and that cell also is bounded by a cell membrane or plasma membrane. But this plasma membrane is not enough to give protection from the outer environment. Hence, the body of the protozoans are naked. That is, they do not have any hard capsule or covering, but they are covered with a testor pellicle. This testor pellicle is made up of generally silica or calcium bicarbonate. This is the figure of Euglena, where you can see this outer green covering is termed as pellicle. So this is the outer protective covering. It protects this testor pellicle protects the protozoans from the harsh environmental conditions. The sixth point is that how do these protozoans get internal support? Like we humans, we have bones or skeleton that give us internal support, but these protozoans are made up of only one cell. So how do they get internal support? So for internal support, they have epiplasm. So what is epiplasm? The epiplasm is actually made up of filaments. So these filaments form a network of cytoskeleton, and the cytoskeleton forms a dense supporting structure, and this dense supporting structure that is made up of filamentous cytoskeleton, a network of filamentous cytoskeleton, that supporting structure is called as epiplasm. The next point is about nucleus. So every animal cell, almost every animal cell possesses nucleus. The nucleus contains a genetic material, but different protozoans have different numbers of nucleus. For example, the upper picture is that of an amoeba. Here you can see that only one nucleus is present. So uni means one, and nucleus from nucleus we get the word nucleate. So that means amoebas are uninucleate. They have only one nucleus. However, the lower picture is that of paramecium. In case of paramecium, you can see there are two nucleus. One is large, called as macronucleus, and the other is small, called as micronucleus. That means paramecium have two nucleus, and that means they are multinucleate. So some forms, maximum forms of protozoans are uninucleate. That means they have one nucleus. However, some protozoans have more than one nucleus. For example, paramecium. The eighth point is about nutrition, or how do these protozoans derive nutrition. If you recall the definition, you can say that the protozoans have heterotrophic organisms. They have different types of eating behavior or feeding nature. Now these different types of eating behavior are holozoic. This holozoic type of nutrition is found in amoeba. Holozoic means these animals feed on other smaller plants or animals, like we find in amoeba. The next type is holophytic, that is found in Euglena. Now holophytic means these animals can make their own food. That means Euglena can make their own food. The next type of nutrition is saprophytic. That means these animals derive their nutrition from the dead and decaying organisms. The other type is mixotrophic, where the animals can have a mixed type of nutrition. That means they can either they can make their own food, also they can derive nutrition from other organisms. And the last type of nutrition is the parasitic. Parasitic means protozoans derive the nutrition from other living organisms. And the body in which they live is called the host. And generally, these protozoans derive the nutrition from the body of the host. As a result, the protozoans are benefited, but the host does not get proper nutrition. So these are all about the different modes of nutrition found in protozoans. The next point is about the locomotory organelle. We know that protozoans are motile. They can move from one place to another. But how do they move? Like we humans, we have legs to move from one place to another. The protozoans have three types of locomotory organelle, that is cilia, flagella and pseudopodia, that will help them to move from one place to another. The cilia is found in paramecium, and the cilia are small hair-like structure. They are many in number and found on the outer body surface. The next type of locomotory organelle is pseudopodia. The pseudopodia is actually projected of the cytoplasm, and they are found in amoeba. And the next type of locomotory organelle is the flagellum. This flagellum is also a hair-like structure, but it is longer in length than the cilia, and these are found in Euglena. So cilia, flagella and pseudopodia are the three types of locomotory organelle that are found in the phylum protozoa. The next point is about digestion. So how do these protozoans digest the food matter? So they are made up of only one cell. So digestion has to occur within the cell. So intra means within, and cellular comes from the word cell. That means digestion occurs within the cell of the protozoa. So for the total digestion process, these protozoans have different types of organelle. The first thing is the cell mouth or cytosome, through which food particles enter the cell. The next Organelle is the food vacuole within which the food particle enters and is digested. And the last part is the annulpore or cytoprot or cytopyes through which the undigested food matter goes out of the cell. So first the food matter enters the cell through the cell mouth or cytosome. It is digested in the food vacuole and the undigested food matter goes out of the cell through the annulpore or cytoprot. So these are all about the digestive process. The next process or physiological process that we are going to know is about respiration. Respiration means how do these protozoans take in oxygen and give out carbon dioxide into the nature. So they do not have any particular organelle. So the respiration takes place through the outer body surface. Through these protozoans exchange the gases, that means they exchange oxygen and carbon dioxide through the outer body surface. The next physiological process is excretion. So for excretion also they do not have any particular organelle. Excretion also occurs through the body surface. However, for osmoregulation they have contractile vacuole. These are the star-like organelle. These are the contractile vacuole and they help in maintaining the water balance. So these contractile vacuoles are very important for the maintaining the water balance in the cell of the protozoans. The next important physiological process is reproduction. So reproduction can occur in two ways, that is the asexual method and the sexual method. In case of asexual method, fission and budding are the processes. So what is fission or budding? So in case of asexual reproduction, only one parent cell is needed. Now during unfavorable conditions, the parent cell starts multiplying the nucleus and forms a cyst or hard covering on the outside. Now these nucleus goes on multiplying, and when they get favorable conditions like humidity, rainfall or sunlight, then the cyst ruptures and all these multiple nuclei along with some cytoplasm ruptures and get out into the environment. The next is about sexual reproduction. The next method is sexual reproduction, and it occurs by conjugation or syngamy. Now in case of sexual reproduction, two individuals are needed for reproducing or giving birth to the offspring. In this case it is very important because the exchange of genetic material or the exchange of nucleus takes place. This is the image of conjugation in paramecium, and here you can see that the genetic material is exchanged between the two paramecium. So it helps in reviving the characters of the offspring and it is very beneficial for them. So this was all about reproduction, that is it occurs by two methods: asexual method by fission or budding and sexual method by conjugation or syngamy. But no embryo forms in this developmental process. We know what is embryo, that is developmental part that occurs during the birth or during reproduction, and blastula is a very important stage in the embryonic condition. But since no embryo forms in protozoans reproduction, so no blastula stage is found in the protozoans. And the last point is that all the maximum of the protozoans are aquatic. They live in water. Now they can be parasitic, commensal or mutualistic. Parasitic means these protozoans live in the body of other host or other living organisms and derive the nutrition, get benefited, but the host is deprived of the nutrition. In case of commensal, the protozoans live in they live with another organism but they do not harm that other organism. And in case of mutualistic, the protozoans live with other organism in a harmony, that means both are benefited. The protozoans are benefited as well as the other organism with which the protozoans live are also benefited. So this was all about the different general characteristics of protozoans. You must understand each of these characters to understand the classification or the basis of classification. So that was all for today. If you like this lecture video, then do like, share and subscribe to my channel and press the bell icon so that you may get the notification of the next lecture videos. And that's all for today. Thank you.